Under the Newsroom tab of the official World Health Organization website, it explicitly states that there are about 50 million people with dementia worldwide and nearly 10 million new cases each year. Although this seems like a very slight percentage of our world population, many people are influenced by such diseases, including those who suffer from them, as well as their loved ones and caregivers. Good evening. My name is Eliana Corsino, and it is with great pleasure I am here today to inform you of the relationship between music and the brain. We will be discussing the way in which the brain perceives sound as music and the manner in which music affects the brain and in turn behavior, specifically in dementia patients. To begin with, the basis of the connection between music and its influence on the brain is the process in which sound is perceived. As written in the second chapter of the 2003 book by author Tom Holmes, Electronic and Experimental Music, sound is produced by air pressure waves that cause the eardrum to vibrate as it passes through the ear canal. As you can see here, this is your ear canal right there. There are actually four types of sound waves, and these are characterized by their variances in pitch and amplitude. You have your sine, triangle, sawtooth, and pulse waves. Sine waves are very simple, and they do not have a harmony, similar to a whistle. The triangle waves are similar to sine waves, but they do have a harmonic element of side bands that complement them as well, and that's like a trumpet. The sawtooth waves are sharp and hold twice as many harmonies as the sine waves, so that would be like the sound of a clarinet. And lastly, the pulse waves, which would sound like a combination of a flute and an oboe, those jump quickly from their lowest point of their wave shape to their highest, as indicated by Holmes in the second section of chapter 2. So going back to the pathway of sound waves, once the auditory nerve of the eardrum vibrates, three small bones in the middle ear are further functioned to amplify the sound that is sent. These are those three bones. And they send that signal to the cochlea, which turns it into an electrical signal. According to Holmes, if the wave vibrates in a regular pattern, it is perceived as a pitch sound, but if it does not, then that is just a regular noise. The vibrations sent to the cochlea cause ripples in the fluid, which hair cell bundles move to. These are the hair cell bundles. And these hair cells transform the vibrations into electrical signals released to the auditory nerve as neurotransmitters, which send messages to the brain in the auditory cortex of the temporal lobe, as stated in the Psychiatry Review article written by Shamsul Haq Nizami and Sai Krishna Tikka from the Department of Psychiatry, Central Institute of Psychiatry. So this is the process of the neurotransmitter sending the electrical signal to your auditory nerve. This is a diagram of the ear. So to summarize that, the sounds that we perceive go through the ear canal, are amplified in the middle ear, and sent to the cochlea, where the neurotransmitters are released to your auditory nerve to send a signal to your brain. Now that we all understand how sound is perceived, we can continue to explore its effects on the brain. So as the control center of the human body, the brain perceives and relays signals in response. So this means that the brain is constantly in control of one's behavior and actions based on the various contributing factors of signals received from internal and external stimuli. Understandably, sound is processed in the temporal lobe, which is right below your ear, and so is the amygdala, which, when stimulated, actually regulates your fear and your aggression, as stated in the sixth chapter of the electronic textbook Neuroscience Online, provided by the Department of Neurobiology and Anatomy. According to the the study elaborated upon by PhD Ina Choi and her colleagues in effects of group music intervention on behavioral and psychological symptoms in patients with dementia, a pilot controlled trial. Patients who were treated with music therapy showed a greater improvement in their severity of their symptoms after 15 sessions compared to their control group, especially in regards to agitation, which, like I said, that is dealt with in your amygdala, which is also in the temporal lobe. So this finding proves that as music is perceived, other parts of the brain are also affected. So in another study addressed in the European Journal of Internal Medicine by professors Gianfranco Cervellin and Giuseppe Dulippi, it was found that in elderly people with gait impairment, which has to do with your walking patterns, music-based multitasking training prolonged for 6 months was able to improve their walking and balance and significantly reduce both the rate of falls as well as the risk of falling. Therefore, music is not just heard, it is listened to and felt. On a basic level, music is just a combination of sounds, even though the manner in which the brain perceives it is very complex. Some may argue that music is distracting, but it is clear that the brain may actually benefit greatly from it. Dementia patients suffer greatly from deterioration of their brain's functionality, but music can help restore such use. With that, I would like to conclude this presentation. Thank you for listening, and please don't forget the power of music.